Tomorrow, Secret Service Director Kimberly A. Cheadle set to testify before Congress following last week's assassination attempt on Donald Trump. And breaking this morning, NBC News has confirmed reporting that the Secret Service denied earlier requests for more security resources from Trump's security detail over the past 2 years. We should note those requests did not include the rally where Trump was shot. In response, a spokesman for the Secret Service said in part, quote, in some instances where specific Secret Service specialized units or resources were not provided, the agency made modifications to ensure the security of the protectee. This may include utilizing state or local partners to provide specialized functions or otherwise identifying alternatives to reduce public exposure of the protectee. Joining us now is NBC News and MSNBC national security analyst Clint Watts.
Clint, with everything that's been going on relative to Butler, the Butler shooting, the Secret Service has been under an incredible microscope. What's your assessment of this new information that's coming out now that there were requests for additional help on the former President Trump's team and the fact that you've got the director coming to Congress tomorrow to have a little chat? How do these narratives play out in your view?
Yeah, Michael, I mean, it's not surprising to me that they were asking for more resources over the last 4 years. If you just look at everything that's happened at Mar-a-Lago and with the president, it has been a pretty dynamic time, especially with all the court cases. I'm sure that necessitated some more of those requests. At the same point, going all the way back to when Congresswoman Gabby Giffords was shot more than a decade ago, there has been a call for more resources, more protection resources to protect candidates and elected officials everywhere they go. And it's always been one answer. There's just not enough resources to do that. The federal government isn't staffed that way. So the answer has been to augment with state and local law enforcement. In the case of this rally, those rallies are put together very quickly. And as we're learning now, it seems like the shooter may have reconned the site before the Secret Service had ever even been there in terms of the location. That just tells you the pace at which these locations need to be secured, how complex it is, how to bring in state and local law enforcement. I think the other thing that's not talked about enough, I would love to know more as this comes up, and I think we will, is in Butler, how many local law enforcement officers are there in total, you know, when you're trying to secure a location like this? They likely had to bring in local law enforcement from many miles away or many different jurisdictions to do that. So I think it's going to be a really bumpy set of hearings coming up. And every time we, you know, see one of these questions asked, the answers are not going to be very good in terms of what we find.
Clint, I mean, you hit on the fact that the Secret Service and staffing has been an issue. It has consistently been an issue. Interviews with former agents and in an NBC News review of government documents and reports reveal that there is an agency struggling to retain agents and keep pace with the threats. That's what the Secret Service is. And so what can be mitigated here? Like, what can be done? Because I think that there's two things on the table. One, it's what happened in Butler and how, who's going to answer for that from the Secret Service perspective, and how can they prevent that from happening again? And then there's a question of, well, what resources does the Secret Service need to adequately do its job? Because they are protecting all of the living former presidents, all of the current president and vice president, their families. Like, this is an extensive apparatus here on top of the other duties that the Secret Service does.
Yeah, just in terms of staffing, I mean, it does not explain why that building was not in the perimeter and not secured. It just was I think we'll find out that that's a failure. But across the board, you're looking at the number of current and former presidents, plus all of the candidates around the country in particularly violent times. If you just rewind the last 5 years, there are more threats likely to any and if maybe all candidates nationwide. That's just going to put an increased demand overall on all law enforcement to protect these individuals doing activities as part of their campaigns. I think the second part of it is the outdoor versus indoor dynamic. You've mm-hmm. already heard a lot of discussion from the Secret Service about how hard it is to secure outdoor locations and keep the principal protected. And this all came at the time when the RNC was probably the principal focus of the Secret Service during that time leading up to when President Trump was shot. So you add all of that together, it is really a perfect storm for something to fall down and fall away. And I think that's what we're going to find out in these hearings, is there's just a lot of priorities, a lot of moving pieces. And this was, you know, a situation where they really didn't adequately secure this and probably didn't have the resources to do it.
I am struck, Clint, by the rare bipartisan nature of the calls for this hearing. This is from the New York Times, a statement by Raskin and Comer. Americans have many serious questions about the historic security failures that occurred at the campaign rally in Butler, Pennsylvania. When you think about that hearing, how do you structure so that you both ask the questions about what happened to make sure that it never happens again, but also push the conversation forward? I mean, is it a conversation about funding? Is it a conversation about recruiting? How do you actually account for the gaps?
Yeah, I'm sure they're going to focus, Alicia, on the actual event, because there's plenty to discuss in terms of why it wasn't there. The other thing is, there's just been inconsistent information come out in terms of what happened. Was there a request for resources or not? We've had different answers on that. You know, was it inside the perimeter or not? Where were the response teams? Sounds like they might have been in the warehouse, but that wasn't very clear. At the same time, the shooter is on top of the warehouse. So I think most of it, at least in this initial hearing, is going to focus on what happened on that day. And I think that's where we should focus. Over time, though, you know, the competing demand is, we've seen a lot of defunding or, you know, real pushes to actually make the government smaller. Well, in each of these cases, when you look across the board for law enforcement, the expectations add up to, there is no way to go smaller. We got to go larger in terms of resourcing.
Clint Watts, as always, thank you so much for your expertise and for your time. And NBC News Digital is taking a close look at the attempted assassination of Donald Trump. They're using video and witness statements to recreate the event. It's called The Line of Fire, Analyzing the Trump Assassination Attempt. You can see it now on NBCNews.com.